Hi, I'm Bob Kalka, Global Identity Lead for IBM.
And I'm Tyler Lynch. I'm the field CTO for HashiCorp, now part of IBM. And today we're kicking off a multi-part series on cyber trust, but we're focusing on identity and access management.
But we're looking at this from a perspective that's different than the typical discussion we have with clients today. Because in most shops we walk into, we have a separate discussion with IT about human identities and a separate discussion with DevOps or platform engineering on non-human and machine identities. And the disconnect between the two in most shops is evidenced by the fact that 80% of all cyber attacks today involve identity somehow. So it is clear that the way organizations are doing this today with disconnected teams and tools, such as trying to turn on a user behavior analytics in the security information event management tool in the SOC, that just everybody does it, but it doesn't find much. It's clear that we're not being effective enough in managing human or machine identities, let alone doing it together.
Yeah, and so hackers aren't just hacking in anymore. They're logging in. And so today we want to talk about patterns and practices for identity and access management that you can apply today using the tools you have. Since we joined IBM, you know, we have focused on non-human identity traditionally. As we've joined IBM, we've listened to feedback from our customers and we've worked with them. What we're finding is that the IT teams typically own human identity. And that can be defined as workforce identity and access management, YAM, and consumer identity and access management, CIAM. But then the platform or DevOps teams own non-human identities, which is essentially a principle for your applications to run under.
Exactly. So we're going to talk about how do you address managing both human and non-human identities. And we're going to talk about it relative to a concept of an identity fabric. What identity fabric means is that a lot of vendors will go in and say, look, the answer is throw out all that stuff you have and use my stuff, right? And that's not pragmatic at all, especially with what we're going to show you here. So what the identity fabric concept is take the technologies that you have, augment it with some AI-based capability, et cetera, so it literally forms a fabric that works together better, all right? So let's start with the human identity side. Whenever we go into a client to talk about human identities, typically to IT ops or the CISO office, you end up talking about the two basic types of identities. You have your workforce users, which of course are your internal users, and then you have your consumers or in public sector, the citizens, right? And that's all your external users. And when we go into a client and we say, okay, what's your strategy for handling that? Almost 99% of the time, what we get as an answer is the name of a tool, some identity provider, Okta, IBM, Ping, ForgeRock, Microsoft, whatever. And they'll say, well, we're based on moving to this new cloud-based tool, and we've got kind of a directory of users as well, typically Active Directory or something like that. And that's what we're doing. And we'll say, the question was, what's your strategy? And that's the name of a tool. And the response is typically, well, you know, we kind of looked at everything out there and we think this is the right one for us. And then I'll say, well, what about all the other IDPs you have, such as you probably have at least one, if not more, for your workforce users. And if we're being honest, what we typically see is a 20 to 25 year old homegrown identity management system that the organization's been trying to get rid of for 15 to 20 years that's still there. Some on-prem system, and then some new cloud-based system. Now, that alone is an issue, of course, but then we get to the next level of the problem, which is you find there are a ton of legacy applications out there. And how do legacy applications, where oftentimes the guy or gal that wrote them isn't even with a company anymore, they typically don't support multi-factor authentication, let alone passwordless technologies, how do they do identity management today? Well, they typically have either a side file baked into the application of usernames and passwords, or they're using
maybe a SQL table.
Yeah,
could be a SQL table,
exactly.
Usernames and passwords. If we're lucky, they might even be hashed passwords.
Yep,
they could be local password accounts. It could be any number of ways that we provided authentication and authorization traditionally over the last 10, 20, 30, 40 years.
Exactly. See, this is a mess, but we haven't gotten to the best part yet, because then you got to add in your hybrid multi-cloud investments where you're managing identities in those as well.
But it's not just identities in those. You're managing your workforce identities in those, so your folks can access those clouds and take elevated privileged actions on those control planes. And oftentimes you're also managing your consumer identities using native directories and tools inside those clouds. So now this problem becomes even bigger.
Even bigger, because all of this is just for the human identities. We haven't even gotten to the much larger set of identities out there.
For non-human identities. What is a non-human identity? Let's break that down a little bit. We see non-human identities in four major categories. First is machine identity. This is the identity of the application or workload that's operating. We will then see identities around API keys and API access. And there's a number of different ways to do this, but let's just classify them as APIs. We then have PKI, so public key infrastructure. This could be X509 and other ways. And then we have AI and AI agents. Now, recently we did some analysis, and 80% of the Fortune 500 cited AI in their earnings report. We know that this is a growing and evolving space. We've been doing this for decades, but really it's become in vogue. And with AI, we're starting to see proliferation. Not only do you have the identity for the AI agent that's oftentimes elevated, you have the identity of the person using that agent. The agent must act on behalf of.
Exactly. So think about this picture, right? If you pull in both the human and non-human identities, we have, let's say you're doing zero trust focus in the organization, you're gonna have a policy that says least privileged access, who has access to what? Where do you actually enforce that policy? Guess what?
Go ahead.
We are managing it in all these different places.
And there's most likely a IDP of some sort and a directory over here as well. Any number of things can be used to support these.
So you see why this is such a mess, is that both within human and non-human identities, where oftentimes you're having secrets hard-coded into applications, is it just leaves itself to a lot of places where the water can trickle through of a cyber attack, right? So what we in HashiCorp have found is that there's a couple of dozen different use cases of things people would like to be able to do but are unable to do. But there are six that really stick out to us that every conversation we're having with a client ends up on these topics. So what we want to share with you are what are the top six use cases that people would like to be able to do that this mess is making next to impossible for them, all right? So the first use case is what we'd call identity observability. Now, what is that? Now, cool kids might call this thing Identity Security Posture Management, or ISPM. What this means is, can you find the sloppy implementations of human and non-human identities that could lead to an attack being more effective? For example, can you find the secrets hard-coded into applications? Can you find a shadow directory that some department set up 5 years ago that was supposed to be gone 4 years ago, and now you have 3,000 people using it, and IT has no idea that it's even out there? Can you find the shadow assets, the shadow identities? Can you find that stuff? Now, that's just within, say, non-human identities and human identities. The even bigger piece of identity observability is being able to watch how the non-human and human identities are interacting, which nobody's been able to do until recently. I'll give you a good example. We're seeing all over the place. You'll have a non-human machine ID on a server getting access to backend systems. And all of a sudden, 20 human users start regularly, often using that same non-human service account. And of those 20 human identities, 8 of them were inactive for the previous year and a half. That is clearly a potential problem, but nobody's had that level of observability, not just human and non-human, but how they're interacting. So that's the first use case. The second one
is frictionless access. When we say frictionless access, we mean removing the username and password from the logged in experience and really making the user experience easy and seamless. This can be with passkeys and other ways that we can do this, but frictionless access is something that we're talking about a lot.
Yeah, because it radically improves the user's experience with your online systems. At the same time, it radically increases the security of it. So that's why people want to go there. And think about our discussion around legacy apps. They don't even support MFA. How are they going to possibly ever get there? So people want to move there, but they're held back by the physical reality of how the identities are handled. Now, these two are kind of like obvious ones, but the next two are really focused on the non-human identities because it is a huge issue.
And so what we talk about a lot is centralized secrets management. And this is centralizing where you're going to store secrets for non-human identities. This could be API keys, database credentials, root cloud credentials, and the like. So having a central control plane to store them and to revoke them, but also to audit against, so we know who's accessing them, using them, and how often. And that's really where people start. They start with centralizing their secrets, but they're oftentimes static secrets. Yeah. Raise your hand if you've ever had a database credential that you didn't change. They're oftentimes very long-lived. So what we want to do is encourage our customers, where it makes sense, to move to dynamic credentials. And dynamic credentials are just-in-time created credentials when needed. Application A needs to talk to application B or web service B, and we can create them dynamically. We can also bind them so it's only that caller and that target that can be using them. This becomes really interesting because if you have static secrets and somebody makes an oopsie and accidentally commits code to GitHub, we know with empirical evidence that people are scanning GitHub commits, and as soon as the credential hits GitHub, they are already being used and exercised to try to gain access. It is almost instantaneous. Dynamic secrets removes this risk from us. So when we can move there, we want to move there. But before dynamic secrets, we often get to just rotated secrets. If you have static secrets, rotating them regularly, that could be every week, every 30 days, every 60 days, get rotation. Rotation also provides the ability for immediate revocation. Mm-hmm. So if a secret was to get leaked or compromised for some reason, you already have mechanisms in place that are fairly easy to operate to rotate that secret and to reduce that risk.
So think about the gulf between where most shops are today versus where Tyler just articulated you can get to. You go from hard coding secrets into app to having an auditable static secret all the way to dynamic secrets, right? And so you wonder why these are amongst the top use cases. So let's close out the top use cases with the final two. And you're all going to groan when I share this next one, right? Because the next one is privileged access management. I still remember when Sarbanes-Oxley came out in 2003 and the first government bulletin was thou shalt do PAM. Right? The most privileged users, you want to make sure, both human and non-human, you want to make sure you spend extra careful attention to them. And yet, the typical shop today has only rolled out PAM controls to 20 to 70% of their privileged users, leaving 30 to 80% unprotected. Not only have auditors jumping all over this, but the whole cyber insurance industry is beyond obsessed with this, because we know firsthand they're going into chief information security officers, for example, and saying, prove to us you know where all your privileged users are and that you've got proper PAM controls, or we're not going to renew your policy, or we're going to up the rate like this or something like that. Nobody wants to be responsible for that business problem, right? So PAM and getting it rolled out to 100% has become a huge issue. And then the final use case, which is coming up in every conversation, kind of takes the first one around identity observability to find the shadow assets in the weak spots. And it's what do you do in real time to protect the system? And that's actually what a lot of people would call identity threat detection and response, or ITDR. That is the ability to find when a SOC is struggling to find identity attacks. How do we move the threat detection and response closer to the identity engines themselves? That's what ITDR really is. And it's being able to find like the policy bypasses. So one of the most common problems we're seeing today, you'll have a user authenticating it against a directory, hopefully not one of those one shadow ones that you didn't know were there, and it's accessing an app that according to the policy must go through MFA. And yet, if you look at the network traffic or the cloud traffic, they authenticated, they accessed the app, but there was no activity against the MFA engine, you've got a bypass. Are you able to see that? It is so common, it's unbelievable right now. So, MFA bypass, ZTNA bypass, VPN bypass, even secrets management bypass. Can you find those bypasses? That's what ITDR is. So those are the six use cases, and I'm assuming you probably agree with us. We're seeing this everywhere. People want to be able to get here, but they're struggling with how to do it. So
let's talk about how you get started.
Yeah.
So in phase one, we do inspect. Inspect is how do we find secrets? And so secret identification and secret discovery, where are they living? So we find secrets in all places, configuration, code, Confluence pages, Jira, wikis, ServiceNow tickets, we find them everywhere. So being able to inspect and do secrets discovery to understand what is the inventory of secrets that are out there and how big is this problem for us?
Yeah, as a CISO told me once, if you can't see it, you can't secure it. right? And so finding the secrets and then doing identity security posture management of finding the shadow identities, shadow directories, shadow assets, et cetera, is huge, yeah. Right? Then what comes next?
Protect. So protection is, well, how do I protect these secrets that I know exist? The first one's going to be centralized secrets management.
Exactly.
Second is going to be PAM, privileged access management. Third, ITDR, and behavioral analysis.
So let's talk about those final two for a minute. Because ITDR, once again, ITDR has gotten to be a hot phrase for the last 2 years, so it's starting to lose its meaning because everybody says, oh yeah, that's what I happen to do, right? We're going to be very specific about what we mean by ITDR, and that is finding those policy bypasses as well as the attacks on the identity system itself. Behavioral analysis is very interesting because the number one identity attack right now is leveraging a compromised valid credential. And when you leverage a compromised valid credentials, a study came out from our cost of data breach study last year, that it takes 292 days on average to identify and contain an attack that originated with leveraging a compromised valid credential. So doing behavioral analysis of things like looking at typing rate of the user when they authenticate is when that leveraged compromised credential is happening, you can watch it as it's happening. You can find it in the first 10 seconds as opposed to waiting 292 days to actually go do that stuff. That leads us then to the final step of the process,
which is governing. And so we can think about governing as the governing the life cycle of our secrets and of our identities. And so this is machine identities, this is human identities, really considering the full life cycle and all the workflows that are involved. Employee onboarding, employee offboarding, principal onboarding, principal offboarding, revocation, denial. It is a full life cycle, and we need to treat it as such and treat them as consistent workflows for human and non-human identity.
So govern brings the consistency, protection brings the little protect, and inspect helps us find those hidden things that we couldn't see. That's what we're going to talk about in this series around managing human and non-human identities through an identity fabric. So thank you for your time.
Thanks for joining us.